We're here for the fun, silly wave.
That's correct, yes.
Okay, right.
It looks like someone's just pulling on space-time.
Not really sure what I'm looking at.
Fast time.
So stuck.
When?
How do you feel about taking it right in the face?
Dan, are you nervous?
Well, that was a very unique building we had access to there.
I love the fact that they just let us mess around with it. It's this incredibly scientific and precise equipment, and they were like, go wild.
Your life jacket going off, unexpectedly, almost wet myself.
I think I even said, I was like, huh, I'm surprised this hasn't gone off. And then about 2 seconds later, it...
I think they're activated by salt, aren't they? Like, it dissolves and it activates.
Yes, the salt in the
thing. Little salt crystal.
Yeah.
Did it hurt taking the spike wave in the mouth?
I thought it was going to, but it actually didn't.
I really like that shot where it sort of tunnels around your face. You look like you're in a weird room that's moving.
Totally surreal. No one had done that before. It was quite an honor, really, to be the first smashed in the face with it.
Yeah. So I think it'd be a good idea if we learn more about waves in general, but also learn a little bit more about the facility.
So we had a little chat with Tom.
Dr. Thomas Davey, you're the senior experimental officer here.
Yeah, correct? That's correct. Yeah.
Okay, so you can tell us all about what you do here, essentially.
Yeah, so this is a facility which essentially is just to model the sea at about 20th scale. And we use that for lots of applications, testing things like wave energy devices, tidal energy devices, basically anything which we put in the sea.
Okay, so if you make a small wave about this big in here, you imagine it's 20 times the size, that's what you're imitating, essentially, in the ocean.
Exactly.
So how long did it take to fill that thing?
It did take us 3 weeks.
So 3 weeks?
We don't like taking the water out of it. So it's 2,500 tons of water in this tank.
And what was the choice behind making the tank this specific size?
If you go much bigger, things start to get very expensive. If you go much smaller, the scaling laws start to work against you.
Imagine this was cheap then.
Yeah. So you're looking at about £6 million of investment just to build the tank. And actually, the whole project's probably around 12 to 15 million.
Might be one of the more expensive things we've messed around with, if I'm honest.
Cool. So how do you get the waves to do the exact thing you want them to?
Well, this is the only large circular wave and tidal tank in the world. So what we have is 168 wave makers around the edge. These are basically paddles. So each individual paddle on its own can generate a wave. But because we're in a circle, you can imagine you can actually then generate from any direction. So you can have this one wave going in one direction, you can have thousands of waves coming from all directions. You know, it's a bit like playing a musical instrument. You just combine all these notes together to create a very complex sea in the tank.
Whoa!
And then on top of that, you then put tidal currents in.
So you can make currents as well underneath?
Yes, so it basically works a bit like a conveyor belt. The current comes from underneath the tank, over the top, and back around again.
Okay. You said you can replicate any part of the sea. If I said to you, I want to replicate Brighton, I want Brighton, could you do that for me?
As long as you've got the data. If we can get good data for a site, and we can understand the energy at that site and the directions of the waves and so on, then yes.
That way, if you just bought in a load of sand, and people didn't fancy the like 8-hour drive, you could have people just come in here and enjoy the...
Yeah, maybe it's our weekend business.
Thanks, Tom. That was really interesting. And thanks for letting us use your very expensive pool.
No problem.
Back to you, Gav and Dan. Thanks, us. Why don't we learn some more about waves?
Yeah, we've invited someone along who's travelled the world and written a book about all the world's scariest, largest, fastest waves. It's called Tides. Hi, Jonathan. How's it going?
Hi, Dan.
Hey.
Could you explain to us the difference between waves and tides?
Sure. Waves, as we talked about, are generally created in the storm, right? There's a one pulse that makes the wave, and then the waves travel away from that. But a tide is actually also a wave, but it's the largest wave on the planet. And it's a long, low wave that travels about 450 miles per hour around the globe. We don't experience it as a fast-moving phenomenon because if we're on the coast, we have to stay there all day to watch it pass, right? 6 hours, the trough, which is low tide, and then about 6 hours later, the crest, high tide.
So you could potentially be on a plane unknowingly flying at the same speed as a tide rolling through.
That's right. The oceans actually aren't deep enough for this free wave, this wave of tide, to travel as fast as it wants to travel. So essentially, it drags its legs on the bottom of the ocean and slows down and creates friction.
Friction against the entire Earth.
That's right.
Wow, yeah. Because I've heard that they occasionally will add a leap second to the clocks to compensate for the Earth slowing down.
Tides have literally slowed down the rotation of the Earth, acted as a brake.
Because the tides are slowing down the world by friction on the bottom of the sea, that means that over millions of years, there's changed the amount of hours in a day?
Yeah, about 400 million years ago, our day was 21 hours long, not 24, because of the tide.
I'm okay with it because I feel like I'd struggle to fit everything into a 21-hour day.
Yeah, what, so you think in like millions of years when it's a 30-hour day, people are gonna be like, a long day?
Yeah, the days got longer and then people started having longer meetings. I think that's what happened.
Yeah. So when we filmed the footage in the wave pool, it looked a bit like a sound wave in 3D space. Now, you've done experiments before with vibrations and frequency to try and show what's happening with the tides, and you've asked us to get this stuff here.
Yes, this is the Chladni experiment, and that little device over there is a sine wave signal generator. Mm-hmm. And it's going to function like the sun and the moon, the vibrations from the sun and the moon. And this area here, this is the ocean. And we're going to put some salt on that, and it's going to demonstrate how the salt will dance around or resonate with the various signals from the sun and the moon. When scientists look at tides, it's really all about the oceans responding to the vibrations or pulses or beats from the sun and the moon. So what I've got here is a way to look at that. So go ahead and pour the salt on there, and okay. As you turn the signal generator on...
You want to do it?
Well, you're the sun and the moon.
That's fair. Yeah.
So as you turn the signal generator on, you'll start to see patterns form here.
Why don't we start with 60? Oh, it's a bit of movement around the edges.
Gibbering.
It's gibbering. I like that.
Oh.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
It's bouncing.
That's cool.
An X. Can we get more salt on there?
Sure, let's get a bit more on
that. None of that salt wants to be in the middle. That's interesting.
Oh, that's really weird on my eyes. It looks like static from a TV.
Oh, it's spreading. The circle's getting bigger.
Weird again. Oh.
Oh, yeah.
It's made two lines perfectly.
And that's not a huge jump. And now that's two
completely
parallel lines.
As the frequency alters, so does the pattern, which is an indication of how the patterns of the tide change with frequencies from the sun and the moon.
78, here we go.
Whoa.
Steady on.
Oh. I need to pour more on it.
Oh, it's,
it's making like
a plus sign.
All right, go on then. I'm gonna run out of salt here. Oh, quick. Oh, it's making a circle.
A bit of an acorn, that one.
Lovely. Do you like the little tappy technique?
Yeah.
That is so weird looking, the middle part.
So this shows how the ocean tide is basically a response to the vibrations of the sun and the moon, a pattern response.
You know, it might be worth whipping out the Phantom for some of this. It's what we do, after all.
Yeah.
Okay, the Phantom's set up, 1,000 frames a second in 4K. Dan, what would be your preference of frequency?
I think we started at 60 and went to 67, and there was a lot of activity and jumping around.
Yeah, there's a lot in the middle, so I think we can...
Also, the sides were pretty cool as well, because it just went crazy at the sides and everything went...
Yeah. Mental. Well, as you can see, we've got the whole thing in the shot, so whenever you're ready.
Okay, I'm going to whip it on and crank it up. Are we ready?
Yeah.
So this is 60.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 67. There you go.
Whoa. Why don't we walk over here and have a look at this?
Okay.
It almost looks like a poker chip at this point.
Oh, there you go. It's starting to change here.
Oh, now you got the corners kicking up.
Oh, yeah, these are getting absolutely annihilated in the corners here. In the far corner, especially. There's
and
lots
you can
of
already see the lines, the parallel lines forming. Look at the wobblage here. It's kind of mesmerizing. You can just stare at that for ages. I love that experiment.
Very cool.
I could watch those all day. Very cool.
Well, thanks very much, Jonathan, for coming in and lending
thanks,
us
Gavin.
Some of your
thanks for your knowledge.
Loved it.
Well, that was a lovely episode. I thought I learned a lot about waves, had a good time in Scotland.
So did I. I got slapped in the face by a wave.
That you did.
Pretty much lost all the knowledge about waves when I got hit.
Punched straight out of your head.
Yeah.
Hopefully you also enjoyed that video. Feel free to check out other episodes of Planet Slow-Mo. And you can subscribe to the Slow-Mo guys if you want. We would love that, wouldn't we?
Yeah, we would.
Yeah, deeply. Scotland rules.
Haggis.
Kilts.